Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents It Takes Monsters by Mandy McHugh. Read by Alex Picard. 1. It was a beautiful Friday in October when Victoria Tate decided to murder her husband. Standing over the sink with a mug of coffee, she watched the morning unravel on their quiet cul-de-sac. The idea had been floating around her mind for years, if she was being honest. Nestled and familiar, like old curtains flapping in the breeze. Not that Warren suspected anything, of course. Why would he? She'd never given him a reason to doubt her loyalty. She was his second in command. His adoring wife. He was the boss. The CEO. And the title chafed her. A little voice whispered that what she was planning was wrong. A sin. Victoria hadn't gone to church in a long time, but she was pretty sure that if God didn't want her to kill her husband, then he wouldn't have made him such a prick. Once upon a time, she'd believed those three letters would be attached to her name. She was a force at Livingston Corporation. Thriving. From lassoing big-ticket clients to negotiating contracts that would make Mark Cuban cry, Victoria proved time and time again that not only did she belong at the dinner table, but that she was hosting the entire goddamn meal. It should have been a no-brainer. Then, stupidly, she'd married Warren. It was what everyone had expected her to do, regardless of her accolades. She was a Livingston. Livingston women got married and had babies. Victoria thought she could be different. She could have the husband and the home in Kentwood Manor and the successful career. She didn't have to choose. Her father had owned Livingston, after all. Nepotism aside, she was the best at what she did. She thought he would understand. How wrong she had been. 10 years down the road, and Warren wanted to dump her like yesterday's garbage. He didn't want out of the marriage. That would be too simple. She almost wished divorce was on the table. Instead, he wanted her dignity, one of the defining characteristics that made Victoria Tate who she was.
"We're running out of time. A few years is all I'm asking for, Vic," he'd said. "A family could be good for us. It could be good for you. The sabbatical forms will be on your desk in the morning. We can clean out your office together and figure out a solution for your accounts, for a nursery. All of it. Trust me, Vic. This is what you want."
He'd smiled, like the matter had already been decided. She guessed in his mind it had been. Black and white was kind of his thing. Warren wanted a kid. Victoria was going to give him one. End of story. Having a child was not the issue. She had nothing against children or women who made it their life's goal to be the perfect mother. It was simply that Victoria had no clue if she wanted to be one of them. Wasn't she supposed to know? Wasn't every woman ingrained with some biological pull once they reached a certain age? Victoria didn't feel a maternal tug. But she didn't have the luxury of pondering what that meant. Warren was taking away her choice. Victoria couldn't wrap her head around his logic. Warren hadn't interacted with a kid since the Children's Hospital fundraiser dinner the previous year, and that had solely been for the photo op. He wasn't going to leave his job. He wouldn't sacrifice his early morning golf outings or late night meetings for a screaming newborn. He most certainly wouldn't throw a burp cloth over his YSL button-down, let alone change a diaper. That would fall to Victoria. And how was that fair? She loved her life the way it was. She loved her independence. A child would change all of that. Acknowledging her misgivings didn't make her a bad person. It made her rational, practical. Warren, on the other hand, how could he be so callous? Blindly assume that she'd drop her clients for a car seat?
How could he take everything from her without even asking for her input? It wasn't like he'd have to endure the physical changes, the hormonal swings, the delivery. She wasn't some empty vessel waiting to be filled. They were supposed to be partners, in love and in labor. Pun intended. But Warren's declaration that she was leaving Livingston and she was having his child had confirmed her long-held suspicions. He didn't see her as an equal. He didn't see her at all. She gripped the mug hard enough to feel the ceramic crack, and then forced herself to relax. She didn't lose control of her emotions often, but this morning, she was finding it difficult to maintain her composure. Anyone would, Victoria thought. It wasn't every day that a person's entire world shifted. The life she'd constructed teetered on the brink of an abyss. She and Warren skirted the edge in a dark dance for power. Like hell was she going to be the one to fall in. 2. On a normal Friday, Victoria would finish her coffee, shower, and head to the office. Her meetings would wrap up, her accounts would be balanced, and she'd finalize her schedule for the upcoming week. Most often, her day would be punctuated by a scoop of chocolate chip cookie dough and whatever true crime documentary Netflix suggested for her, while Warren indulged in whiskey. Today, however, she wasn't going to work. Not when she'd have to sit in front of an HR rep and sign her life away. Warren would be mad, but she couldn't bring herself to care about that. She was mad, too. Setting her cup aside, Victoria tucked the front of her shirt into her jeans and slipped into her Sperry's. She grabbed her keys with a quick glance at the mirror over the foyer table. One low ponytail later, and the bored housewife starter kit was complete. Cookie cutter chic. Easily forgettable. Exactly the vibe she was going for. She was ready. The ordinary morning happenings of Kentwood Manor were in full swing by the time she reversed out of the driveway. Neighbors collecting the local paper in their robes. Parents exchanging small talk at the bus stop. Would she be one of them? Victoria wondered. She would be, right? She would have to be. Coordinating outfits with the other mothers and Pinteresting bento box lunch ideas. Nope. Victoria squashed that train of thought before it derailed into a full-blown panic attack. Despite the chill, Joe Waterman's landscaper, Ted, was already mowing the lawn, nodding along to whatever music blasted through his ridiculously large headphones. Rashad Banks, in his navy blue base sharkskin suit, buffed a spot from his Mercedes M-Class. He winked as she passed, which drew a smile in return. He was handsome, and he knew it. Had that whole BDE thing going for him, which was a popular topic of discussion in the neighborhood, book club. Victoria used that term loosely. A group of horny middle-aged women drinking wine and drooling over smut while their kids were at school was a more accurate description. Warren wanted her to be one of them. She shuddered. The Sparrows, retired busybodies with too much time on their hands, rocked in Adirondack chairs and waved, big dopey smiles glued to their Florida weathered faces like an ad for a prescription drug. Near the end of the street, Betty Naughtier, resplendent in neon leggings and matching sneakers, pumped her arms like a shadow boxer, lips pursed in exertion.
Morning,
she called.
You look ridiculous,
Victoria said through ventriloquist teeth and gave a beauty queen worthy wave. Normal. Predictable. Just another glorious morning in Kentwood Manor. At the development entrance, Victoria turned left instead of her usual right, heading away from the city into the rural landscape that comprised the other half of Kentwood County. Back roads and farmland opening before her, she found her favorite true crime podcast and tuned out, letting her thoughts wander to the details of crime scenes and forensic mistakes. Corn stalks whipped by while the host dissected facts about fibers, soil samples, and genetic material under fingernails. Victoria examined her own manicure, a sensible length with a neutral color. Warren didn't like flashy. Flashy didn't win deals or change diapers. A burn settled deep in her chest. She imagined her fingers digging into his neck, nails pink and pretty against his reddening flesh, collecting his genetic material in the struggle. That wouldn't do. Victoria would be smarter. She wouldn't leave evidence. She would wear gloves, she thought, parking in front of Miller's Hardware. Just in case. 3. The hardware store screamed of nostalgia and reeked of sawdust and gasoline. Vintage metal signs advertised soda and car services. The shelves were made of thick wooden planks, worn from years of use. It was cute. Quaint. Best of all, it had no security cameras.
"Help you?"
asked the man behind the cashier's desk. White hair stuck out from his stained baseball cap, but wiry muscles stretched beneath his gray thermal shirt. Working man's muscles. Something Warren would never have. He'd slip a disc lifting a bag of potatoes. Okay, that was a little bit bitchy, she thought, looking at her own arms. She guessed the same could be said of her. Pilates toned, but not strong by any means. It wasn't like she was lugging hay bales in the afternoon sun. Honesty, like good and evil, like everything else, was arbitrary.
"Drop cloths?" Victoria asked. "And some leaf bags, if you still have them."
"Yeah, we got them."
He stuck out a gnarled thumb and hitched it to the right.
2 rows back for both. If you hit the nails, you've gone too far. Hard to miss, though.
She thanked him and moved quickly past the rows of tools and appliances. The plastic drop cloths were piled in wire baskets at the end of the aisle. She grabbed 2 rolls, paused, took 2 more. 3. 4. And a few rolls of painter's tape. Items secured, she skirted the corner and found lawn bags stacked on an end cap. Perfect. She added 2 big boxes to her pile of Dexter-level spatter-proofing and headed for the register. The man stood at the counter wiping black grease from his hands with an equally blackened washcloth.
"All set?"
he asked, dropping the cloth into a bin at his feet. She placed the last of the items on the small counter.
"Yes, thank you."
"Find everything okay?"
"Yes, thank you," she repeated.
He tallied up the prices on scrap paper and entered them into the register.
"We don't accept credit cards here, ma'am, just so you know. Never did care much for those big companies. The fees will suck you dry."
"That's fine."
It was why she'd gone to Miller's in the first place. Hopefully, that was the last of the small talk.
"Doing a little home improvement?"
he asked with a chuckle as the bell above the door jingled. She nodded. Something like that.
"Victoria?"
a voice squawked behind her.
"Oh my God, what a small world. I was just thinking about you."
Shit. Betty Naughtier, neon queen of the speedwalkers. She was still wearing her blindingly bright athletic wear, but she'd exchanged her runners for a pair of day glow Crocs.
"Betty," she said, "so good to see you."
They exchanged a quick hug and a cheek kiss. That woman was all about the cheek kisses. Victoria struggled not to swipe the ghost of spit from her face. Betty's cloyingly sweet perfume hung heavy in the air between them.
"What are you doing here?"
she asked, all big-toothed and wide-eyed, shouldering her oversized purse with the grace of a donkey.
"Just picking up a few things."
The cashier clucked his tongue, inserting himself into the conversation.
"Looks like it's gonna snow tonight," he said. "Early this year."
"Ugh, how do you find the time?" Betty mooned, ignoring him with a pointed eyebrow arch. I need some of your motivation. If you could bottle it up for me, that'd be great, because if I worked half as much as you did, I'd be a slob kebab by happy hour. And you're painting again? Didn't you just have the trim done? I remember seeing the utility vans outside your house for a few days.
Victoria didn't miss the disapproving frown. God forbid the unsightly work vans parked on the street. She'd probably been watching to make sure they left before the HOA cutoff with a bag of low-calorie popcorn and a seltzer.
We did, yeah, but they missed some sections, she said with a smile that she hoped looked more natural than it felt. Then they should come fix it.
Betty scrunched up her nose in faux outrage.
Who did you use? I'm sure if you let them know you're dissatisfied with the work, they'd come back.
Call me a perfectionist, she said. I don't want to rely on someone else to do the job right. Details are important.
Yes. Yes, they are.
Victoria didn't appreciate the Mona Lisa smirk that accompanied Betty's agreement.
Well, she said, motioning toward the register. Hey, did you hear about the Mahonies?
She asked, lowering her voice to a conspiratorial whisper.
Not the Sherman Ave Mahonies, the Edgewood Court Mahonies, the ones with the yapping dog. They petitioned the board to install an above-ground pool. Can you believe it? I mean, it's clearly against the rules, but they're arguing they should get an exemption for health reasons.
Health reasons? He eats a sausage McMuffin every morning, and he wants to talk about health? I told Fiona, I said,
oh, for Christ's sake,
Victoria thought.
I'm sure everything will be fine, Betty.
Betty's energy furled inward in a mixture of confusion and rejection.
I'm sorry to cut this short, but I should get going if I want to get this done before the snow.
She really did not want to gossip in front of the cashier, who was eyeing them both with more than a fair share of judgment. Nothing drew attention faster than conflict. She'd have to keep that in mind.
Of course. Don't let me keep you. We'll get a drink soon, all right?
Sure. I'll check my calendar and get back to you.
You do that.
Betty grasped Victoria's forearm and squeezed twice. Send my best to Warren. With a flip of her dried, sweaty ponytail, she sauntered away.
Well, shit, she thought. So much for keeping a low profile.
4. Leaves whipped around the parking lot in crisp, rusty arcs. The temperature seemed to have dropped 10 degrees since she had left the house, the wind raising goosebumps on her arms. October snow wasn't uncommon in upstate New York, but that didn't mean she had to like it, or the potential complications such a storm would bring to her plans. The weather wasn't her only obstacle, however.
Freaking Betty Naughtier,
Victoria mumbled, retrieving the car key. She popped the trunk and dropped everything inside unceremoniously before sliding into the driver's seat. What were the odds of running into her obnoxious neighbor? Of all the places and times. She could have easily hit the Home Depot closer to the manor. As much as Betty advocated the shop local mentality, she hadn't met a chain store she could say no to. Why Miller's? Maybe she had a legitimate errand. Or maybe she was sticking her neon-colored bloodhound nose where it didn't belong. It wouldn't be the first time. Controlled chaos was Betty's specialty. It hadn't been a year since her last drama unfolded, when she'd inserted herself into the nighttime activities of her next-door neighbors. George had been having an affair. Stacy had been in denial. Betty had been curious. She took to following George and eventually caught him leaving his girlfriend's house. Sex hair be damned. The photos she posted to the Facebook HOA page spoke volumes. Victoria watched the mess from afar but concluded that the entire scandal said more about the kind of person Betty was than anything that happened between George and Stacy. Victoria, however, had no desire to be the new featured drama on Next Door. She started the next episode of My Favorite Murder and pulled out of the lot, tapping erratically on the wheel.
Each mile tightened the notch of tension in her shoulders. Face flush and skin warm, she rolled down the windows and gulped mouthfuls of cool air until the drowning sensation passed. Of course she was on edge, she told herself. It would be weird if she wasn't. People didn't off their spouses every day. But she could do this. She would do this. Not because she was born a Livingston and had some medieval birthright claim to the company, although there was some truth there. Not out of some ill-conceived notion that women belonged on top, as much as she believed in the feminist quest for equality, murdering Warren didn't fall under that umbrella. It was the injustice of the situation. The fact that one man could sweep in with his dick-swinging energy and demand she bend a knee in order to give up her body, her freedom, her choice. If Warren had broached the topic beforehand, maybe Victoria would have considered his point of view. As a courtesy, she wasn't unreasonable. She wasn't a monster. And even if she wasn't 100% convinced that motherhood was right for her, she would have been willing to listen. A few years. She would be a relic by then, professionally speaking. As much as she hated to admit it, men could leave the game and be welcomed back with open arms. Two martini lunches never went out of style. Most women weren't given the same treatment, especially after a maternity leave, when the inherent assumption was that she would have to drop everything for a child. Had some places made progress? Sure. But Victoria was under no illusion that Livingston was one of them, not with her father setting the precedent for Warren. She could kick and claw her way back in, but it wouldn't be enough. Victoria pressed the Bluetooth button on the wheel. Maybe her sister could offer deeper insight. Call Tegan. After four rings, the recording began. You've reached the voicemail of Dr. Tegan Livingston. I'm unable to take your call right now, but... It's your personal phone, Teagues. Why are you introducing yourself like a quack on an infomercial, you colossal narcissist? Knowing Tegan, she was probably watching the screen and waiting for the call to end. Then she'd wait a few extra minutes before texting a response. Sorry, I was busy grafting someone's face back on because I'm a doctor, in case you forgot, doing doctor things. What's up? A plastic surgeon. It's barely a doctor, Victoria said, smug in her dismissal. Well-respected doctor or not, Tegan was decidedly insecure when it came to Victoria's opinion. She tried to hide it behind follower counts and celebrity name-dropping, but it carried a note of desperation. Tegan craved her approval, and part of Victoria, one that she tried not to look at too closely, loved not giving it to her. Did that make her petty? Perhaps. But for the first time in her life, Victoria couldn't find it in herself to care. 5. Victoria stacked the Miller's haul on the table. Insides jittery, chest tight. Her hands were steady as she gripped the counter. She was making the right call. This was the only course of action. Nerves were normal. Her phone whistled, startling her out of the internal pep talk. The world didn't stop because she was facing the biggest moment of her life. Money was pushed, clients were irritated, and business kept moving. 16 new emails since she checked this morning, all from her VIP list. She may not be CEO, but Livingston couldn't function without her. She shook her head and tapped the first message from Jeff Blevins, the ever-present thorn in her side. Account execs weren't supposed to keep tabs on each other's client lists, but Jeff had been trying to poach from her for the last 3 years. Ever since Warren had picked him for a prestigious leadership summit, where all the major players went to schmooze and pat themselves on the back. Of course, it hadn't been Victoria. They couldn't possibly risk having the team accuse him of nepotism. Her numbers drew enough speculation as it was. Jeff was the obvious choice. And here he was, emailing her before business hours about one of her clients. "Heard this through the grapevine," he wrote. "Thought you'd want to know." How altruistic. Gratuzzi and McLeod, her biggest account, had decided to jump ship. 3 years she'd spent building a relationship, nurturing a meager one-off service fee into insane profit margins. And now? They were citing customer service issues as their reason to withdraw from their arrangement and go with Livingston's biggest competitor. Customer service? Code for bullshit. Victoria could read the red between the lines. It had absolutely nothing to do with the fact that Warren insisted he handle the last round of negotiations, or how he'd inexplicably transferred them to a subpar service team where more than half the reps were in their first 3 months of employment and knew nothing about the systems. Livingston had already lost two of its most lucrative accounts this month, and before Warren had dropped the surprise you're being ousted baby bomb, she hadn't blamed them for leaving. Big fish always smelled trouble first. They'd been able to hide the departures, at least temporarily, from the shareholders, mostly because Victoria knew how to smooth the rough edges of desperation. There wasn't a chance in hell the facade would stay intact for another quarter. Also, it wasn't a good look that Jeff had found out about this before she did. "Shit," she said, shooting off a few quick responses to frazzled account execs that she would circle back after the weekend with a fresh game plan. She wouldn't have to make up for Warren's slack for much longer. Not if her plan worked. As the last email sent, an alert for a calendar change popped up on the screen. "This can't be happening," she thought, reviewing the notification. Everyone wanted to be wildly unpredictable today, it seemed. Wasn't like she had a murder to execute. Victoria pulled up her call log and tapped Warren's name. No answer, which was odd. For all his ineptitude, Warren didn't miss her calls, especially when he was supposed to be free until his dinner meeting. She hung up and tried again. This time, the call went straight to voicemail. Was Warren ignoring her? Well, that wasn't going to fly. She swiped to her contacts and hit the main line. "Livingston Corporation, how may I direct your call?" Warren's secretary, Judy, a comely woman with a small gap between her front two teeth and a penchant for ramen, crooned into the speaker. "Hi, Judy, it's Victoria."
"Mrs. Tate, how are you?"
"I'm well, thanks," she said, driving straight to the point.
"My calendar just updated, and I was hoping you could confirm the change. What's going on with the Harvest Gala? The RSVP was for next weekend."
"It was supposed to be," she said.
"What happened?" "Oh, it's awful," Judy said, frown evident in her voice. "Margaret's mother has taken a turn for the worse, I'm afraid. They were hoping for good news, but her last test results weren't great. So they bumped it to tonight in case Margaret needs to make arrangements."
Margaret Connors. The Kent Wood socialite. She and her ridiculous husband, Barnaby, lived in a mega mansion on a private cul-de-sac at the other, filthy, richer end of Kentwood Manor. For anyone else, rescheduling an event of such magnitude with no notice would be impossible. But for Margaret Connors, the proud stay-at-home wife who ultimately controlled Barnaby's wallet, the city would move Christmas to June if it meant the cash flow continued. "I didn't know her mother was still alive," Victoria said. "She's never come up in conversation."
"Well, she won't be for much longer," Judy said before immediately backtracking. "I apologize, Mrs. Tate. That was incredibly crass of me."
"No worries," she said.
"Neither will Warren."
Judy's voice lowered to a conspiratorial level. Victoria could almost see her twirling a strand of her copper waves as she divulged the news.
"One of their housekeepers told me she has cancer, stage 4 in her pancreas. Terrible, right? Margaret is completely torn up. She wanted to fly her up from Long Island, but she's too weak to be moved, so they've hired the entire staff of a private practice to give her round-the-clock care. Margaret's taking the jet down first thing in the morning and plans to stay, but she refused to cancel the gala. So it's tonight. All of that stays between us birds, of course. I'm not usually one to gossip.
Unless there was another person within earshot.
What time does the gala start? She asked. 7 o'clock at the Kentwood Mansion.
Does Warren know?
Judy paused. Mr. Tate has been in meetings for most of the morning, but I'll check with him before he leaves for lunch.
He's leaving for lunch? She asked dubiously. Warren ordered from Lorenzo's on Fridays. Every Friday, without fail. Grilled branzino with rice pilaf and 2 cannoli. His only cheap meal of the week.
He had me make a reservation for 2 at the new Thai place downtown.
Did he say with who?
The keyboard clacked through the speaker. Another pause. He didn't. He's on a conference call with Hobart's CFO, but I'm sure he wouldn't mind if I patched you in.
That's all right. Thanks for letting me know, Victoria said.
Of course. Happy to help. I'm here until 4 if you need anything else.
The call ended, and Victoria stared blankly at the rolls of plastic and painter's tape. A reservation for 2. Warren would never choose a Thai place. Vanilla was spicy to her husband. So who was he dining with?
6.
Victoria navigated the online appointment system for Atelier's salon and scheduled a blowout for the last available slot of the day. The last thing she wanted to do was waste an hour in front of a mirror. But if she'd learned anything from her father over the years, it was to keep her business clean. Following surface-level expectations was necessary to maintain her air of innocence. If she showed up to the gala unprimped and flat-faced, Margaret would 100% call her out, drawing attention where she didn't want it. She scooped up the materials from Miller's and stuffed them in a bottom cabinet, out of sight, in case Warren decided to come home early. Being observant wasn't a trait Victoria would ascribe to him often, but he had his moments. Her stomach grumbled, which struck her as both funny and odd. How normal it was to feel hunger when she was coming to that fork in Robert Frost's proverbial woods. Granted, most people misinterpreted that poem, not realizing that the path never mattered. She was going to end up in the same place regardless of which direction she chose. In that, Victoria found comfort, a sense of rightness. One way or another, they would have always wound up here. With an apple in one hand and her phone in the other, she skimmed the messages in the Kentwood Manor group chat. News of the gala was spreading fast. Her neighbors rallied in excitement while fretting about the weather. Many complained about the burden of securing impromptu babysitters.
That's going to be me, she thought. Warren wants that to be me.
Scrounging for childcare at a moment's notice, competing with the other mothers for who pays the most or who has the best snacks in the pantry for some teenager flicking through TikTok, begging for an iota of responsibility while trying to figure out which dress hides her post-baby weight the best. Okay, she didn't have time to stress about what Warren wanted anymore. She needed to focus, and that wasn't going to happen with a thread full of neighbors arguing over curfews and parking fees. Wishing everyone luck with gala prep, she padded across the darkening foyer up the stairs to their bedroom. When Victoria had met Warren one star-crossed evening, he'd bought her a beer and delivered the cheesiest pickup line she'd ever heard. So, aside from being sexy, what do you do for a living? It was still cringeworthy. But she also smiled at the memory. The ruffle of his dark hair, the curls at the nape of his neck. How shaggy, yet tailored, he seemed. The way his blue eyes gleamed under the bar lights. She had loved him that night. She was sure of it. He was smart and witty and unbelievably charming. Victoria had been surprised at how hard she'd fallen, but didn't fight the attraction. Her father had adored him. Her mother had approved, which was high praise for Claire Livingston. She didn't realize how royally she'd screwed herself until it was too late. Until her father had handed the company to Warren. At first, Victoria had thought it was a test, some ill-conceived plot he'd cooked up to push her limits and prove her worthiness. A very Jeremy Livingston thing to do. So she'd risen to the occasion, grew her client list, banked crazy hours, increased revenue. She'd hosted dinner parties and registered for a goddamn yoga class to sweeten the relationship with the CEO of the largest female-run financial institution in the Northeast. But the aha moment never came. Warren stayed at her father's side, and Victoria was banished to the shadows. The longer the denial, the more certain she'd become. Her father wasn't changing his mind. Not even Tegan had been able to find the logic. That she and her sister had agreed on something spoke volumes. Victoria hit the lights and sat on the tufted cream bench in the center of the closet. Her evening gowns were spaced evenly apart on velvet rods to protect them from wrinkles. Some fashion faux pas were acceptable, often debatable. White after Labor Day, denim on denim, pattern mixing. Those rules could be broken. But nothing said careless like wrinkles. And maybe trace evidence. Victoria would be guilty of neither. Every gala had a theme, and this year's was the art of nature. She doubted Margaret and Barnaby had spent any discernible time outdoors, but that wasn't important. People came for the extravagance, not to see who could best understand the assignment. Victoria's gown fit the bill for both, however. She'd chosen it months ago, scouring websites, department stores, and designer trunk shows until she had her "say yes to the dress" gasp. The rich reddish-purple hue was technically called Tyrion and would have been right at home on Game of Thrones. Made of lightning and fit for a queen. From the kitchen, the phone rang. Warren insisted on having a house phone for emergencies. Only punch-drunk telemarketers and automated survey bots called landlines anymore. Another archaic notion which proved that Warren was incapable of adapting to a progressive mode of thinking. Left up to him, Livingston would stay in the glory days of the 90s, all handshakes and hired escorts. The answering machine activated, blasting Warren's voice into the silence.
Hey, Vic, it's me. Missed you at the office this morning, and you haven't answered any of my texts. Should have told me if you weren't coming in. I wanted to go over the contract before I sent it to Lauren in HR. She'll have the final e-doc for you to sign once we get this taken care of, so check your email and get that back to me ASAP. Judy's got boxes coming for your office on Monday. I hope she got a hold of you about the gala. Okay, talk soon.
Contract. Boxes. Monday? Like hell she was signing that document. She jumped when her cell vibrated in her pocket, Warren's name blinking onto the screen. She wondered if it was possible for someone to strain an eyeball rolling it too hard. Warren, Victoria said.
Nice of you to pick up, he said,
and she mouthed a silent curse at his snarky tone.
I just left a message at the house. Why aren't you at the office? Where are you?
Home. I felt off this morning and cleared my schedule. About to head to the plaza, though. Duty calls.
Ah, I see.
He didn't see. What's up, Warren?
Nothing. You heard my message? About the e-doc?
Heat rose up her chest. I heard.
Great. Glad we're on the same page.
The relief in his voice was palpable. She was about to call bullshit when he pressed on.
Listen, I've got to cut this short. I'm about to conference with James. Had to cut some corners to make the gala work. I just wanted to make sure you knew about the contract. We'll talk more tonight.
Lie, she thought. James ran an international financial organization in Cape Town. If Warren knew anything about time zones, he would have known that it was almost 10 p.m. there. What's more, Victoria happened to know that James was on a digital-free retreat. How is Lorenzo's? She asked wearily. He hacked a cough.
Hmm? Oh, good. Same as always. Fish was a little dry.
God, Warren was a terrible liar.
He was hiding something.
And while she couldn't deny that she wanted to know what that something was, she didn't press her luck. There was no need. Warren would either tell her the truth or he'd die with his secret.
There's always next week, she said.
All right, well, I have to get going.
Sure, right. Listen, don't wait for me tonight, Vic. I'll just meet you at the mansion.
She stood and crossed the room, counting the footsteps from the bench to the bed. Continuing down the hall and stairs, she paused at the closet and hooked her arm through her coat sleeve.
You're getting ready at the office?
She looped a scarf around her neck and opened the garage door.
Christ, it was cold.
She cinched the scarf tighter and jumped into the car.
I have everything I need with me, he said. Going home would be impractical.
Didn't that sound loaded?
Okay, I'll see you there.
Bring up a bottle of red from the basement, too. The vintage Merlot. I think we'll both need a glass after tonight.
The engine thrummed. She switched to speaker and pulled down the visor, rubbing the smudged mascara in the creases under her eyes.
Why?
I'll meet you at 7,
he said, ignoring her question. So, he was going to continue to be cryptic. The call disconnected as she eased onto the street. Warren's comments left a bitter taste in her mouth. There was no way he'd figured out what she was planning. Not a single person would suspect Victoria of being capable of homicide, least of all her husband. She'd set herself up well in that regard. Volunteer work and charity, and never, not once, uttering a word of disapproval at Warren's promotion. But if he wasn't suspicious of her, why was he lying? 7. Victoria pulled into Kentwood Plaza and spent an hour at 9 West, wishing she'd made the drive to Neiman Marcus and Paramus. Kentwood was seriously lacking when it came to designer selection, so she settled on a classic black stiletto heel with strappy details that would meet the bare minimum of the Connors dress code. Wasn't like she was showing up in Crocs, though. That was Betty Naughtier's job. Shoes handled, Victoria braced against the wind and took the covered sidewalk to the salon, tucking her chin into her coat. The door sealed with a whistle, and she was devoured by the cacophony of hair dryers and conversation. Kimber Charles appeared wearing a black sleeveless sheath dress and studded Oxfords. She'd been the premier stylist in Kentwood since the early aughts, when she relocated from the city to start fresh after a messy divorce. Her jet black hair was straightened into a blunt bob that grazed her chin. Her foundation was contoured and flawless. Her large brown eyes were accentuated by smoky hues and lash extensions, and her full lips were nude, but not washed out. Not many women could pull that off without a filter, but Kimber exuded a natural confidence. Over the years, Victoria had grown to appreciate Kimber for more than her trendy aesthetics. She was sharp, determined, took shit from no one. A woman after her own heart.
Victoria, darling, so good to see you, she exclaimed, locking her fingers in the crooks of Victoria's elbows and pecking cheeks.
Thank you so much for squeezing me in.
Anything for my favorite client, she said, inspecting Victoria's roots and ends with a neutral expression. You've been using that toner I recommended. Love to see it. I'll have you looking like Charlize Theron in no time.
Bombshell Charlize? Or monster Charlize? She thought. Big difference.
Kimber guided her through the swell of the main room to a chair at the end of the aisle.
Classic blowout?
She asked, fluffing the layers around Victoria's shoulders.
It's gotten so long. I'll give you a trim while we wait for a sink to open up.
Actually, no, I'm not sure, Victoria said. Got any suggestions for something a little more daring?
Kimber smiled.
With your bone structure? I've got a few ideas, but why don't you take a minute and flip through this for some inspiration? She handed Victoria a copy of Us Weekly and patted her arm amicably. I'll finish up with Mrs. Middleton. You know how grumpy she gets if her perm doesn't scream microwaved in the 80s. Then I'm all yours, darling. Victoria thanked her and absently flipped through the pages of celebrities. Warren preferred her hair the way it was. Victoria hadn't worn it any other way since she'd known him, just varying degrees of the same long layers. Much like her mother had styled hers. Victoria really didn't want to think about why she might be mirroring those generational beauty beliefs. Not when her actions were the opposite of Claire Livingston's definition of woman. Beautiful, soft-spoken, delicate. Most importantly, a woman was nothing without a man to hold her up. A woman could be so many things, though. That's what her mother had never understood. Victoria was so much more than a pretty, spineless rag doll. How had she forgotten that? With an odor of hair product and vanilla, Kimber appeared at her side. She studied Victoria in the mirror, lashes casting spidery shadows beneath her eyes. What do you think? She asked, pressing her hip into the chair. Did inspiration strike? In more ways than one, she thought. I know exactly what I want, Victoria said with a hint of a smile. Warren's fate had already been decided. It was time to cut the dead weight. 8. The garage door rattled shut, sealing her in darkness. Victoria avoided the rearview mirror, her sheared reflection still an oddity. She dug her fists into her thighs and concentrated on her breathing. Anger, fear, anticipation. It was difficult to determine which was leading the charge. The last time she'd felt this alive had been on the eve of her father's death. Unable to take control of Livingston, yes, but free from his restraints in a way that left her gasping. She wanted to feel that way again, boundless and terrified of the open water, yet eager for more. Inside, Victoria dropped her coat and purse on the chair and kicked off her boots. She shivered at the unfamiliar sensation of the draft on her shoulders, but the resulting chill seemed more like a promise than regret. Following her gut hadn't steered her wrong today. Gathering the materials from the cabinet, she jogged upstairs and inspected the bedroom. The plastic wasn't going to cover everything. The ceilings were too high, and the tallest ladder was stored in the shed to which Warren had the only key. She had enough to cover the immediate areas, however. That would have to suffice. The drop cloths were just a failsafe, after all. Her type A personality refused to let her ignore the potential for disaster. As long as Warren followed her lead, as he did most other nights, there would be no need for murder-proofing. The act would be tidy and contained. What she'd gleaned from her true crime podcasts was that too little planning led to mistakes, and too much planning led to overthinking the execution. Victoria figured that covering her ass in case tonight led to unexpected blood was somewhere in the middle of those two extremes. Wrapping herself in a robe, she opened the first box of supplies and got down to business. The next hour passed quickly. She lost herself in the whoosh and crinkle of materials. Sometimes she would hum a tune. That new Lizzo song was quite catchy. Feel good and representative of the hope she felt blooming in her chest. Mostly, though, she used the time for reflection. She thought about Warren, of course. Their beginning and their inevitable conclusion. She thought about her mother, how frequently and fervently she emphasized the necessity of beauty. She thought about her father, his sweeping demands for her to be the best, even if that meant exposing her worst tendencies. Excellence was never good enough. She had to strive for perfection, no matter the cost. Friendships, lovers, sanity. Victoria was under no illusion that, conventionally speaking, murdering her husband to sever their ties and preserve her free will was frowned upon. That didn't stop the little voice in her head from whispering that, all things considered, Jeremy Livingston would be proud of her decision. Taking a life, regaining a life, balance. Here, she lingered. What would Warren's final thoughts be? Would he recognize that his end was looming? Would he reach for her in the darkness? Victoria imagined him floating away, the lids of his eyes fluttering in unconsciousness. Perhaps that was why she missed the arrival of her sister. One minute she was taping down the corner of a particularly tricky section of dropcloth. The next, her bedroom door flung wide open, slamming into the wall as Tegan charged forward. She waved a knife wildly, casting frantic glances around the room like she was expecting Michael Myers to pop out of the closet. Jesus Christ! The knife dropped to Tegan's side as she stared at Victoria. Seconds. Minutes. She had no idea how long she stood there, fish-mouthed and silent, trying and failing to figure out what the hell was happening.
Tor,
Tegan said, dragging her name through molasses.
What did you do?
Nothing. Yet, she thought, suddenly infuriated by her little sister's accusatory tone. You broke my door.
The door?
She repeated, as if she couldn't be hearing her right.
Sure, the door is the issue here.
Tegan's gaze wandered.
What is this?
Victoria made a noise of disapproval and stood, crossing her arms and giving Tegan the look. The, I'm older and you're annoying, look. She'd mastered it over the years and used it to her advantage whenever she could, including right now. What are you doing here, Tegan? For all her father's emphasis on building a Livingston empire, Victoria and Tegan hadn't quite figured out how to be around each other. Sisters, yes. They shared a bloodline that she recognized and honored. But honing the essence of what made sisters more than siblings, that inexplicable tie that transformed a relationship to a bond, that had always been missing for them. Tegan did not stop by for casual chats or girls' nights. Her abrupt appearance raised all of Victoria's alarms.
Me?
Tegan squealed.
What is this? What are you doing? And what the hell did you do to your hair?
She snuffed the urge to mimic Tegan's dumbfounded expression. Instead, Victoria smirked and fidgeted with the blunt edges. The pixie cut had been a bold choice. Kimber had agreed. But with every inch that had fallen to the floor, Victoria had felt the years of suffocation sloughing off, too. Yeah, she said, her expression softening. I needed a change.
This isn't just change, Tor. This is cleaning out the whole damn account.
She gripped Victoria's chin, turning her head this way and that, inspecting the styled pieces.
You haven't had short hair since...
Since, she interrupted, I was 10, and you decided to play Sweeney Todd? Tegan scoffed.
It was like an inch of hair, drama queen. Let it go.
Let it go, she thought, mentally kicking Tegan in the shin. Their mother had literally banished her to her bedroom for 2 days when she saw what Tegan had done. There had been an emergency trip to the salon, where the stylist agreed that nothing could be done to save her. Her face burned at the memory. I should have shaved your eyebrows off, Victoria said, wrenching out of her hold.
Ah, come on. Are you going to stay big mad about that forever?
Yes.
It was hilarious.
A riot, she deadpanned. Tegan closed the gap between them.
Hey, in all seriousness, you can talk to me about anything. Chopping off your hair is a massive cry for help.
Victoria rolled her eyes. I'm not crying out for help, Tegan. God, I'm trying something new. Not a crime.
Technically.
Bitch, she thought, before a trickle of insecurity took hold. It looks good, though, right? Kimber said it accentuates my long neck and cheekbones. Because as much as Tegan sought her approval, Victoria wasn't immune to the need for acceptance. She waited patiently as Tegan's eyes raked across her face, her judgment calculating like an Instagram filter.
Objectively, yes, it looks good, Tegan concluded. But it's still weird.
Wow, love you too, Teeks. She felt better, though. Weird left room for adjustment, and Tegan would get used to her new look, just like she'd get used to existing on her own. Victoria tossed the roll of painter's tape on the bed before rolling up the excess plastic sheeting, as if this was the most normal thing for her to be doing on a Friday night before the gala.
Don't be a bitch, you know what I mean, Tegan chided. I walked in expecting Rapunzel and found Tinkerbell.
Why are you here? Victoria asked curtly. And why do you have my cleaver? Tegan turned the knife over in her hand like she was seeing it for the first time.
You didn't answer the door or your phone. I got scared. Thought maybe you had an intruder.
You and your horror movies. You need to stop watching Shudder.
Hey, I watch the news too, Tegan said.
Like that's any better. And what did you think you were even going to do with that? She asked.
Stab?
Tegan shrugged, almost dropping the knife.
Jesus, you're impossible.
The absurdity of the situation rolled over her in subtle waves. Tegan was more likely to stab herself in the leg than actually land a blow against an attacker. Her sister was the stuff of fluff. Cotton candy and angel plushies. And here Victoria was mid-murder preparation. I thought surgeons were supposed to be good with a blade. Maybe that's butchers.
Well, I have handled my fair share of meat, so...
Victoria rolled her eyes again, but chuckled.
Cute. Get it?
I was talking about... Yes, please. It's funnier if you have to explain the joke.
All right.
Killjoy, Tegan said. Child. The sisters settled into the lightened moment. A tentative truce in a room full of plastic. 9.
I'll fix your door if you're upset, Tegan said after a beat. But I maintain that I was acting under duress. I was worried about you.
You don't have to worry. I can take care of myself. She sounded like Warren. Objectively, Victoria knew that. Blustery and assured. Did every married couple start sounding like one another after a certain amount of time? Was it inevitable that you'd absorb the vocabulary and mannerisms of your spouse? How long would it be before she was able to detangle her personality from the person she'd become to appease her husband? The thought was both tedious and slightly terrifying.
Of course you can, Tegan said. You're invincible.
She placed the knife on the dresser and flexed her biceps like a superhero. She stood by her previous statement that her sister was a child. How someone who routinely made dick jokes and prided herself on her extensive.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.